that you heard Katie read to you from Paul's letter to Christians living in Rome in probably around 60-62 AD lay the basis for our life together in the church. Yes, for 2,000 years, this passage has laid the core values down for our life together as people of faith in the church. This passage, Romans 12, verses 9 through 21, we just read 16 through 21, but actually 9 through 21, address the core values on which all the activities and ministries of the church and of individual Christians are built. So church, take this passage home with you, your worship bulletin, and I would hope that you would read this several times during the week because of its importance and what it has to say to us. As a faith community that does seek to truly value our patterns and our behavior in the likeness of Jesus Christ, we seek to embody genuine love for each other, agape love, a mutual regard for one another that's not based on the judgments that the wider society might make about us, about things like our color or our language or our dress or our status. We are called to practice humility and solidarity with one another. We are called to exhibit peace and harmony in our interactions with each other. And we practice a way of being and acting every single day that cares not only for the other members of our faith community, but for the stranger as well, the wider society. We are called to be generous. We are called to be hospitable and strive to share all things that we have in common. And I love the end of verse 16. Let us not claim to be wiser than we are. Jesus told his disciples that the greatest commandment is to love God, and then the second is to love our neighbors as ourselves. The thing is, church, how can we proclaim to love God if we are destroying God's beautiful creation for our own self-interest or our own gain? The expansion of our cities, of our populations. How can we love our neighbors when our appetite for energy contributes to the deforestation of homes and natural habitats of others, or the pollution of the water that they drink or the air they breathe? We cannot bury our heads in the ground, ignoring the fact that low-income communities and communities of color often bear the unfair burdens of our collective environmental choices, like landfills and wastes. In today's other lesson, Psalm 104, which is about the greatest psalm of creation that we could ever imagine, God's vision of shalom suggests that we consider God's creation, all of God's creation, as deserving of love and care, not just our human brothers and sisters. And so today we celebrate Earth Stewardship Sunday. And it's a time to celebrate this amazing tapestry of life and natural beauty that God has fashioned for us. As people of faith, we affirm that God is revealed in the wider world in all of the beautiful places that we live. This year's theme is a sense of place. Think about your place that you are deeply connected to. Most of us are native Nebraskans. That place that you grew up, I am sure, is a place that is very dear to your heart. The images, the sights, the smells fill your head even from the earliest years of life. Each one of us is connected to a sense of place, and a strong identity emerges from that sense of place, from the landscape, the flora, the fauna, the climate, and also the history, the legends, and the spiritual beliefs, and the music, and the architecture of that place. All of us are strongly tied to a sense of place. In childhood, what psychologists call a primal landscape develops as our first impression of our sense of place. We connect with the surrounding community, which becomes our home. It becomes a part of our lifelong self-identity, providing the nourishment, the nostalgia, and the comfort that we need even into adulthood. Here in Nebraska, our primal landscape might be prairies, it might be farmlands, it might be the sandhills, it might be the rugged terrain of the Northwest, it might be the rivers like the Missouri and the Platte, or the eastern prairies with the beautiful wildflowers and wildlife roaming. Adults that move away from Nebraska and who come back to visit always have this primal landscape, that which they miss, that which they love. And so it's interesting when I'm visiting with people who are coming back and they want to go out and eat here in Lincoln. If you grew up in Lincoln, let's go to Amigos, or let's go to Valentino's, or let's go to Runza. How we miss our Runza. We don't have those in California or New York. Our primal landscape. This year's Earth Day encourages us to be aware of our natural habitat, our primal landscape, if you will, and what we are actually doing to it. The average adult here in the United States spends 10 hours a day glued to media, basically computers or TV. 80% of our time is spent indoors, and another 6% of our time in automobiles. And it seems as if we are becoming a bit disconnected from land. What is unique about our sense of place? Well, you know, you've learned in Nebraska history early on that the word Nebraska comes from an Oto word that means broad water. And I suppose that because the Oto and the Omaha and the Ponca settled along the Missouri River, so that broad water referred to the Missouri River, maybe the Black River. Native Americans have occupied what is known as our state of Nebraska for thousands of years. At least 15 tribes have either hunted or occupied the area that we call our home. The Pawnee and Arikara moved into the area 4 to 5 centuries ago. And in the early 18th century, the Omaha and the Ponca moved and settled along the Missouri and Platte Rivers. We have named our counties, we have named our villages and our cities after these native people. And so we pause and we pray with the descendants of the first peoples of this state. How are we in connection with our native brothers and sisters? There are 461 species of native birds in our state. What's the state bird, Church? Western. Two middle marks. Western. They're beautiful, but many people who come to Nebraska are in search of the migration of sandhill cranes. And we have 1,500 species of native plants and more prairie and non-forested ecosystems than most other states in the United States of America. We're proud to boast the birthplace of Arbor Day, and we place in the nation's top 10 of tree cities in the United States. We have the largest hand-planted forest. You wouldn't think that about Nebraska, but we have the largest hand-planted forest in the United States, in North America, not only the U.S., but North America. Church, what do we need to be concerned about in our sense of place? We have 27 endangered species on our list here in Nebraska. We have the sixth worst waterway system in the nation for pollution, most of it contaminated by nitrates from slaughterhouses and poultry plants. Our rivers and our streams, we want them to be clean, to be able to swim in them, to drink from them, and to support wildlife who drink from them, not to poison them. Benjamin Vogt, who was an associate professor at the University of Nebraska, was with us a few years ago and talked about the disappearance of the prairies, the tall grass prairies, and how that affects the monarch butterfly. Well, the monarch has made a little comeback since Benjamin's talk to us, but 95% of our tall grass prairies are extinct here in our state. Prairie grasslands are North America's most endangered ecosystem. How will we get them back? Worldwide, over 300 species a week are becoming extinct, in part because of how we choose to live, how we are connected to the land, because we need the land for farming, for the growth of our cities. Once a part of our cities become old and worn out or populated by peoples that are of a lower income or who are different, then we leave and we build. It's wonderful in Nebraska what we're doing to the hay market and to the old market in the cities of Lincoln and Omaha. We have begun to build back in rather than always expanding out. The Apostle Paul says, live in harmony with each other. Live in relationship to the earth. Today, our spirituality, our religious faith, must embrace the way that we live in connection with each other and with our habitat. This is Easter. This is a season of resurrection, of transformation, which means that we must live with an awareness that all creation is alive with the presence of God. That we need these flowers as much as they need us. That we need these prairies. relationship with Earth and with our sense of place here in Nebraska.